Hey everyone, today on John's Briefs, back again with Mark Victor from Attorneys for Freedom, and today we had one that Mark first saw and went, oh my, what, oh my goodness, are you kidding me?
I still feel that way.
Yeah, so I want you to go watch it. It is the video of the cell phone store where the guy walks in as an armed robber, the clerk waits his turn, gets a counter ambush on, and then empties the magazine in the guy. 16 rounds he put in him. I'm pretty sure he was carrying Glock 19. Mark's not super happy about some of those rounds, so let's talk about it.
Today's video is brought to us by the generosity of Firearms Legal Protection. Firearms Legal Protection is a legal defense program for lawful gun owners. You win the fight, and they will help you win the fight after the fight for the rest of your life. There's a link in the description for a coupon code for a discount for all active self-protection watchers.
All right, Mark, so your first reaction on seeing that was, oh my gosh, that was clearly excessive and he's going to get charged.
Yeah, I think the first part's also interesting, right? Because we don't have any sound on this one. At least I didn't hear any sound on it.
No.
So I certainly wouldn't want people to take from this that you walk in the store with a gun and somebody gets to shoot at you, right? So you need something to me a little bit more than that. So I'm going to assume that, because I haven't talked to these people, so I'm going to assume that there was something in that transaction that communicated to the guy behind the guy in the chair, the guy that was minding the store, this is a robbery. I'm here to rob the store, right?
So he threw the bag at him, from what the news story said. He walks in, throws the bag at him, and says, give me the money, with a gun in his hand.
Okay, so, right, because we want to make it clear that just because somebody is carrying a firearm doesn't necessarily mean that there's any kind of a threat, right? I mean, that you have a right to carry a firearm in most places.
Usually not in hand, though.
Well, different states have different rules.
Okay.
So let's just say, there are different rules for different places as well. On your place of business and other places. In Arizona, no problem, unless there's a sign outside that says no guns, or it's one of the places you're prohibited from carrying. But here in this state, people can carry guns, and they can carry them openly, and they don't even need permits for it, as long as you're not a prohibited possessor. So let's assume, for the sake of our discussion, that this guy wasn't just carrying a firearm. He walked in and communicated to the guy who's minding the store that I'm here to perform a robbery.
Yes.
Under those circumstances, I got no problem whatsoever with that store owner or the employee grabbing his firearm and emptying a round into the other guy, or even more than a round, as many rounds as it takes to stop the threat, to neutralize the threat. But it seemed to me the threat...
Hear that on the channel all the time, guys. I say that exact same thing.
Once the threat's neutralized, which to me looked pretty quick in that video, we only watched it very briefly, but it looked to me like this guy's on the ground pretty quick. I'm not saying you pull the gun off the guy. I got no problem with holding the gun while you're calling the police. Because he could be faking. He could grab his gun. There's still risks. That's ongoing. I get that. But this guy, to me, looked like he was continuing to empty the firearm, discharging round after round after round when the threat was over. So I got to tell you, if I'm the prosecutor on this one, I'm thinking this guy may need to be charged with something, because I think he might have gone too far. But in fairness, you know, there are lots of gray areas in these prosecutions. And I've had cases myself where I had a case one time where my guy is in his home and somebody comes in the house and it's clearly a threat. It's clearly an attempt to burglarize the place. And my guy pulls the gun. He's totally justified. But then the bad guy turns and starts leaving. And my guy discharges around.
Mm.
And he gets him more on the side and in the back than in the front. It could have been an argument made that this was too much.
Mm.
But on the other hand, the police and the prosecutor figured out pretty quick my guy was the good guy in the scenario, and these other guys were the bad guys. So I don't want to say they swept it under the rug. They gave him a little bit of extra play on that.
Tie goes to the runner, as it were.
Tie goes to the runner. Same with this one, maybe. This guy minding the store, he's minding his own business. Bad guy walks in. I'm here to rob the store. I got a gun in hand. He's clearly a thug. Tie goes to the runner. If I was defending this guy, or I was talking to a prosecutor to try to convince the prosecutor not to charge my client, the store owner, I would say, look, the threat's ongoing. He still has the gun there. He could have gotten, all it takes is one round.
Moving in his upper body.
Yes, there are some things like that, but I'd be nervous about that, frankly, making that argument. I think this guy probably could have and should have stopped after that first or second round. Whenever this guy was neutralized, to me, if you want to be safe, that's the point at which you stop. You know, because to me, it starts looking like vengeance after that. It looks like I'm trying to take this guy's life. I don't know what happened. I don't know what the arguments were. it can be a little difficult to comment on these videos without having all of the facts. And of course, we both remain open-minded that if there are new facts that come to the table, could easily change our minds on how we look at the case. But based on the little bit that we just got, what we just saw, looked to me like the store owner or the guy that was working in the store probably discharged too many rounds.
So I think there's some interesting stuff here. That number one, there is such thing as prosecutorial discretion.
Absolutely.
And not only, I mean, so that's at every level,
and
right?
We need it. Because you can't make a rule that covers every situation.
Right. And there are times that the cop on the street, is he going to write a ticket or is he not going to write a ticket?
Discretion.
Is he going to arrest for this or is he not going to charge for this? So there's discretion there. And then the prosecuting attorney, there's discretion there. I know from a self-defense perspective, I never want to put myself at the mercy of prosecutorial discretion.
And that's what we're talking about here. So when I give my commentary about I think this guy fired too much, I mean, he probably could have protected himself, neutralized the threat without firing all of those shots. As it turns out, it appears he got away with it. He's not getting charged. And indeed, this is the reason why I think that having the county or the city or whoever elect the prosecutor makes a lot of sense, right? Mm-hmm. Because they do have discretion. No one's talking about we should take that particular area of discretion away from them. But the way they apply it has to reflect the community standards.
Okay.
And if the community doesn't like how the prosecutor is sort of using that discretion, well, the remedy there is to vote in a different prosecutor.
Makes sense. I hadn't thought about it that way, Mark. Thank you for that. I appreciate that. So I think that what I said from a trainer's perspective is you want to have some rounds left in that gun in case the bad guy has some buddies hanging around, right? So putting 16 in this guy doesn't leave me any for anybody else around if, God forbid, he has some accomplices, right?
Also a very good point. Yeah.
So unwise. Now, from a legal perspective, I think that what I'm hearing from you is remember, the prosecutor's going to look at, you may say, well, gosh, man, I just wasn't thinking at all and the gun just kept going off. But he's going to stop that video every round and go, is this reasonable? Is this reasonable? Is this reasonable? And so sometimes slowing your flow a little bit and saying, wait a minute, is he still a threat? Is he still a threat? Do I need to shoot? Must I shoot him again? And when the second it says no, stop.
You know, I can tell you just having interacted with many, even elected prosecutors over the years and how they exercise their discretion. To me, a good prosecutor in a case like this is not going to make that decision. A good prosecutor is going to send that thing to the grand jury.
Let's just say the grand jury gets to make the decision.
Let's take the citizen members of the community. Let's tell them what the law is. Let's present it to them in a way that's very fair. You guys decide whether or not there's probable cause to return what we call an indictment, which is really just the charging document. We call it an indictment because it flags it for everybody. This comes from the grand jury. Mm-hmm. And to me, this is exactly the kind of case you want to send to the grand jury. Let them look at it. Let them decide if, by the community standards, this guy used too much force. But like you were saying before, I want to set the stage so whether the prosecutor decides or the grand jury decides, I want to be as close to the side of no charges as possible. And really what I care about is protecting myself and neutralizing the threat. I think this guy could have had that done in far fewer shots, not even reaching the tactical question that you very correctly point out, that there may be other people out there. He may have buddies coming right up behind him. So putting that aside, I think that you can accomplish what you need to accomplish, which is stop this guy, neutralize the threat, without getting closer to availing yourself, hopefully, of the good nature of the prosecutor discretion or the members of the grand jury.
So here's where maybe we start thinking in the tactical world, because we've talked in the legal sense as well, that I know that when we're out there on the range, we want to run those .18 splits. We really want to shoot as fast as we possibly can, getting accurate hits. But sometimes in the real world, we got to throttle that back enough that we can engage our brain enough that we're still making good decisions with a gun in our hand. Because really, at the end of the day, I mean, when we're talking about a defensive shooting, the jury's not asking, were we a good marksman? The jury's asking, did we make a good decision with a gun in our hand? And so we better be able to do that. And so having videos like this and getting advice ahead of time lets us think about this stuff ahead of time so we make a good decision in the moment. Because honestly, one of the things I've learned from you as well, jury won't even care what my training is. They'll only care, did I make the right decision in the moment? And if I don't, then I'm accountable for that.
Yeah, I'm not even entirely sure it's relevant that you've had a bunch of training.
Yeah.
You know, and I would probably try to keep that away from the jury. Why do they even need to know about that? The question is, did this person act as a reasonable person, and those under the particularities of this circumstance, did they act within the realm of reasonableness? And I would always say, not necessarily the best thing to do, not maybe what you would do, but what a reasonable, sort of a hypothetical, reasonable person in the community would do. Is what this guy did outside the realm of reasonableness? I'm not sure I can say that, right?
No, because I don't think so.
Somebody walks in, flashes a gun, and says, put the money in the bag or whatever. You know, your heart's beating, adrenaline is flowing, you've got this reaction going on with your fingers and you're discharging rounds. I can't say 100% it's unreasonable. I'm just saying, if you can sort of put the brakes on and make a better make it easy for your defense attorney, right? On behalf of all the defense attorneys, make it easy for us, folks. Use the minimal amount of force that's reasonably necessary to repel the attack, and then stop right there.
Awesome. Mark, thanks for the advice.
Thanks for having me.